Hello dear all. In this lecture series, today we are going to talk about an essay titled Definition of a Poem, which appeared as a part of the seminal text of I.A. Richards titled Principles of Literary Criticism. So before moving into the understanding of the essay and how and what are the critical approaches of I.A. Richards about defining a poem, first, let's have a quick look into I.A. Richards as a critic and what are his literary achievements. I.A. Richards, Ivor Armstrong Richards, was known for his textual and psychological approach in criticism. He is considered to be one among the new critics, and Eliot and Richards together can be seen as the flag bearers or the torch bearers of the new criticism in England, and not only in England, but across the Atlantis. Born in 1893, Richards started lecturing at Cambridge and got enrolled himself as a professor of English literature there in 1919. He also lectured at Harvard, and he influenced a number of critics, starting from John Crow Ransom, Kenneth Burke, Clinth Brooks, Empson William, and many more. Because of his strong hold into literature, psychology, and aesthetics and fine arts, his talking about criticism and his views on criticism has affected all these fields of arts and aesthetics. His important works include the first book that he published on criticism with collaboration of C.K. Ogden in 1922. In 1923 also, he published the essay titled The Meaning, or the book actually titled The Meaning of Meaning, that was also in collaboration with Ogden. In 1924 came his seminal work The Principles of Literary Criticism, and in 1929 came The Practical Criticism. Literary criticism is a book which is based on factual, scientific, and critical temperament, and it is of immense magnitude, and it deals elaborately talking about criticism as a psychological aspect. And in his Practical Criticism, which came in 1929, Richards took into a new kind of view of criticism or of reading a poem, and that was that it was a part of his experiment where in his college in Cambridge he used to distribute among his students pieces of poems, and he would not reveal the author or the age who has written the poem, and then he would ask the students to critically analyze the poetry. And what were the various responses he got about various different poems, even from great writers? Upon that, he based his psychological analysis of a poem, and upon that, he based how criticism should be taken into vein, or how a poem must be criticized. And from there only emerged the concept of new criticism and practical criticism, which is the very backbone today of any poetry and the criticism associated with any poetry. So this was the chronology of the various books that Richards published and how he influenced various fields of literature. Now we move on to the text that we are going to talk about today, the essay, that is Definition of a Poem. Now, when I.A. Richards wrote this particular essay, it is actually a chapter in his book, Principles of Literary Criticism. He basically focuses upon how a poem should be defined, or what is the basic essentiality of a poetry. But Richards is known for many other things, like he has talked about the two uses of language, he has talked about how the stimulus and response psychology is focused in the development of a poetry, he talks about the two uses of the emotive use and the scientific use of a language. And then he talks about the four kinds of meaning of any word. And those are the sense, feeling, tone, and intention. So these are many things which are associated with I. Richards. There are many such keywords. But in this particular essay, we are going to deal, which is a very short essay actually, we are going to deal specifically with how Richards defines a poetry. So let's begin. The essay starts with a quotation from Locke, and where he wants to point out, or that quotation points out, the use of words. How men use words without much troubling their heads from their surroundings. They learn from their surroundings. They learn how to use a language. They just imbibe it, and that is how communication develops. Language is something which a child learns from the very beginning of his livelihood. He sees around him, he copies. So he does not indulge into what the word means. He just copies and he gives assigned meaning to that word, which is generally followed in the tradition, and that becomes the language. So language is a natural process. There is no effort required in learning a language, basically your mother tongue. So here also this quotation tells us how words can easily be learned without putting much your mind into the meaning of those words that we are learning. But now he comes to a critic. How a critic looks towards these words and towards these tools of communication, towards the language. So it is always the critic's desire to differentiate between communicative and value aspects of a work of art. Communicative means, like, if there is a sender and there is a receiver, the sender sends the signal, the receiver receives the signal, that is, the communication of language takes place from person A to person B. If the communication is achieved, if what person A wants to convey is received by the other end, person B, communication is done. But when we are talking about any poetry, when we are talking about any aesthetic piece of art, it has some values also attached to it. And the critic basically focuses on these two aspects of any work of art. One is communicative aspect, and the other is the value associated aspect. So he says that first and foremost thing is communication is important. If you are a poet and you have composed a poetry, and if it fails to reach to its readers with the real meaning that you want to convey to your readers, if in somehow some process that communication is lost, then that poetry does not serves its purpose. So communication is important. If no, then value has got no meaning. So if communication is not achieved, the value which the poet is trying to give has got no significance. And here he gives us example of Coleridge and Lamb. And he dismisses them both, saying that their poetries are erratic and eccentric. And their criticism is also erratic criticism and eccentrically interpreted, because they have given values, and values have been associated with their aesthetic works, with their pieces of art, but the communication wise they have failed. So their value has no significance at all if communication wise they have failed. Just like poems like Kubla Khan, it is Coleridge himself defines it as a dream sequence actually, which he saw in his dream, and suddenly he woke up and wrote that poetry. So it is some kind, in some ways erratic, in some ways eccentric, and that is not to be accepted as an ideal poetry. And he also says that critic must be free from personal prejudice, which is what every new critic feels about, that the critic's personality must not be associated with the poetry, and his prejudices must not be associated with the poetry. So even if he does not like anything, but it is true or it is correct with the eyes of criticism, then the poet must accept it. He gives two sentences for this. Says, I don't like this, but I know it is good. A critic must be able to say this. Even if he does not like anything, he must be able to say it out that I don't like it personally, but it is good. That is an ideal critic. The second sentence he says is, I like this and condemn it. So personally, he may like a piece of art, but because on the critical merits, if the piece of art fails, then he is ready to criticize that work of art. Further in the essay, Richard says that any communication is never perfect, because you may have seen this process that if the first person says something and it is carried on with several ears and with several mouths, and when it reaches to the last, the first and the last will differ in their words or will differ in their meaning. So communication is never a perfect thing. From the sender, when the receiver receives the signal, something or the other is lost in that process. But the general idea must be maintained, and that is, he says, the importance of any poetry. For example, he gives the example of Westminster Bridge written by Wordsworth. He says that Wordsworth may, while writing that poetry, had faced some kind of similar experiences. It was not just that he went one day on the Westminster Bridge and he wrote that poem. It would have been in his mind because of several experiences which he had in his visits to the Westminster Bridge. And that experience is the most important thing. So whatever the simile is used, whatever the imagery is used, whatever the symbols are used, means the various techniques which have been used in the poem, they make the poem as a whole, but that is secondary to the main meaning of the text, what Wordsworth tries to convey. So if there are two readers, maybe reader A and reader B, and if they both discuss this poetry, and they may discuss it with two different perspectives. So a perfect poetry is only achieved then and there when each and every individual who is starting that poetry there, or the every reader who is reading that poetry, there some meaning for the poetry does not change. The general meaning, the main outlook, the main idea of the experience which the poet has remains the same. And actually, this is the reader response theory. The practical criticism is basically reader response theory, that reader's response is important, and if all the readers have the same response, then the poetry has achieved its merit. And in this vein, he defines a poem, and he says that a poem, as a definition, is, quoting him, an artist's experience, but only artist experienced it. How can we comment perfectly on it if we have not experienced it? So he says that poem is an artist's experience, and only artist has experienced it. So we cannot comment upon it perfectly. We are just experiencing it after or through the eyes of the writer. So we have not experienced it, but if we near, somewhere or the other, we reach near to the views of the poet, that is enough for the definition of a poem. And at this phase, he looks at poetry with the eyes of psychology. And it may seem odd and complicated, but he says, again I am quoting him, poetry is a class of experiences which do not differ in each character more than a certain amount, varying from each character from a standard experience. So a standard experience remains the same. From character to character, person to person, reader to reader, people may have various opinions, people may have various responses towards the poem, but the general meaning must remain the standard experience which the author experienced. Maybe what Wordsworth experienced when he was standing on the Westminster Bridge, that experience, the general experience, remains the same. Then it qualifies to be a perfect poem. And it's critic's view that he must find sense there. And critic has to find the sense there. That is the reader's responsibility to find the sense in the poetry. And the critic must not misread any poetry. So your eyes must be open. You must be a perfect critic of a scientific temperament who must judge the poetry, keeping in view the experience of the author. And if you reach close to the experience of the author, means the communication has been done perfectly. And if the communication has been done perfectly, then the poet has achieved in composing a perfect poem. The values may differ, the meanings may differ, but the most important crux, the most important line, strain of communication must not be disturbed. The general meaning, actually, the general idea must be retained. So that is all about the definition of poem. And in my next video lecture, I'll bring up his other essays, Two Uses of Language, which is an important essay. So till then, signing off. Thank you.